In 2018, I was lucky enough to attend the forum for the Global Happiness Policy Report. I recorded the meeting because I felt it was important to the prosperity of the happiness movement.
The purpose of us standing together today as a council is that first, we haven't seen each other face to face, so we don't know each other. So when you do speak, please introduce yourselves, describe which part of this overall effort you are involved in, and we will get to know each other this way. Second, it is to first also thank you and appreciate the work. But third, it is to strategize on what to do with this agenda. As a council that is convened by the UAE government in order to inform governments about best practices on promoting happiness, we have an important report. It should be read. It should be known. We did not write this for ourselves. We wrote this as a support to a process of policy change to promote using subjective well-being and other indicators of well-being as guidelines for public policy and to identify critical areas in society such as education, urban planning, workforce development, governance, where there are important opportunities for using a growing evidence base to promote well-being. So part of our goal today is to brainstorm how we can use this report during the year. The second part is to plan next year's report. We have a three-year running room, so three global reports. Our idea is to build an agenda, not to do the same thing again next year, but to take another step forward. I think there was, from our smaller discussion yesterday of the chairs of the various working groups, a sense that next year's report should be a more action-oriented program. Richard Blair's group in the UK is called Action for Happiness. I wanted to steal that for the title of next year's report, at least as the spirit of what we want to do, and maybe literally as the title of what we want to do. But the idea should be that this year is about best practices and cases, and next year should be the how to proceed. So more oriented towards guidance on what to do. I'm not sure what that means exactly from the point of view of each of your subject areas, so that's part of what we want to discuss today. Another point that was part of our discussion yesterday is that there are many events around the year where this work should be highlighted. The idea that we're after is to change the way governance is carried out for the purpose of promoting a different viewpoint, and that is to put well-being in a very conscious way into public policy. And so there are many public policy gatherings throughout the year that are potential arenas for presentation, discussion, and promotion of the agendas. We talked about the fact that the labor ministers gather at the ILO, for example. The education ministers gather with UNESCO. The health ministers gather at the World Health Assembly every spring. The world's finance ministers gather twice a year at the the spring and the fall meetings of the IMF and the World Bank. The heads of state gathered at the UN General Assembly in September. The G20 leaders come together in, it'll be November this year, and the various processes around the G20, such as the so-called T20, which is the think tank of the 20 countries, or the B20, which are major businesses, have their own schedule of gathering this year, organized by Argentina, which is the presidency of the G20. The business world gathers in Davos in January every year. So there are opportunities, if we plan a calendar, for presenting ideas, trying to move forward an agenda. We talked with our team at Duran about hosting ministers at the OECD as a way to move forward the agenda. And we have the World Happiness Summit next month in Miami, which is another place where the results of this work should be made known, because that is, after all, a place where you're trying global public education on this agenda. So we should have copies of the report, and we should have Richard, you're going to be, I think, in Miami. So this is a great opportunity, of course, to present this work as well. So that's our purpose today, to brainstorm on our overall mode of operating as a council. We'll meet again, same time next year, here, face to face. We have an opportunity, I should say, to meet in September next year in New York, if that's of interest, at the General Assembly time, because I'm present to host such a meeting if we would like to do that as well. And we have a not only a set of working groups that will be writing next year's report, but therefore a high-level council, as well as dozens and dozens of experts, many of you that are participating in one of the various working groups that can work throughout the year. That's our agenda. Who would like to thank Jeff, of course, for spearheading this effort with the UAE. It's been very important. In terms of where we go right now, it might be nice if we went through theme chapter by theme chapter, if the leaders are ready to say, digesting what has been learned from what they've done this year and what they're proposing to do next year. Following the order in the report, that would be you first, Richard.
That makes sense.
So the health chapter this year is about mental health. It highlights the scale of the problem, but also the fact that we have ways of dealing with it, which would actually cost nothing. And of course, all of this is going to be said at 6:30 onwards.
So next year.
Later. But next year, our plan is to talk about priorities in the whole field of health expenditure, how to think about that, and some of its implications. For example, the relative importance of improving the quality of life of the living as opposed to lengthening the life of people whose quality of life may be becoming very poor. That's some of these really basic issues that are bothering health plans in many countries. Paul Dolan is going to take charge of that chapter. But we'll have help from, he hasn't composed his group yet. We certainly will have help from, as you probably know, we have an amazing organization called NICE, National Institute of Clinical Excellence, which reviews the cost effectiveness of all treatments for different illnesses. And Mike Williams is an exceptional doctor who got that set up and extraordinarily, uncontroversially accepted. I mean, this is a very interesting example, actually, in relation to our general task of getting happiness accepted uncontroversially. The notion of equality adjusted life share has taken deep root in Britain. It was just an academic idea and thought about 16 years ago, and it is now just the lingua franca. So it's an interesting, hopeful indication that we might make happiness the lingua franca within 15 years.
Honest, next. Marty?
Alejandro Adler and I wrote a report on positive education. Its basic theme is when we ask parents, what do you most want for your children? They say happiness, health, fulfillment, well-being. Then when we ask what do schools teach, they say discipline, conformity, literacy, numeracy, and there's no overlap. So we ask people to imagine the two joined together, the traditional roles of schools, paving the way for the workplace, with education to meaning and purpose and life satisfaction and positive emotion. So in this chapter, we review the spread of it through the world. There are literally tens of thousands of teachers have been taught the techniques of positive education, and hundreds of thousands of children have been exposed. So then the question arose, what do we want to do next year? And the highlight of the discussion for me yesterday was about a world in which there is a happiness agenda, in which governments strive for well-being, measure it, and have policies directed toward well-being, will not happen accidentally. And the important thing about what Jeff said about these meetings with ministers and the like is unless we envision it, unless we talk about the infrastructure and how to do it, it's not going to happen. And that's, I think, the noble goal of the people in this room. So here's what Alejandro and I have been thinking about for next year. First, we want to continue to map the spread of positive education, to quantify it.
That's a good idea. You can see
second, cost-benefit analyses are needed. So there has not been serious cost-benefit analyses. So I look around the room and I see some of the world's great economists, and people are going to need your help on how to do serious cost-benefit analyses. And then most importantly, there's a question of how to do it. So if you're a headmaster or a principal, we have case histories of the obstacles and how to overcome them. And particularly, if you're a minister of education, what would the roadmap look like? And that's so far above our pay grade, I don't know what to say about that. But that's the sort of thing I think we want to map out. So that's what I thought we'd do. Alejandro, was there anything?
Thank you, Marty. I think my takeaway from yesterday is the report currently as it stands, definitely the education chapter is very much descriptive, really scanning the world for case studies of success. So we want to move not towards a fully prescriptive agenda, but really systematize and analyze to really have a checklist of what works and how it works. We realize to galvanize political will and human will beyond the public sector, the private sector, in civil society, we really have to have a simplified of a methodology, a checklist that we can almost spoon-feed ministers, of course, with the adequate cultural and conceptual adaptations, but I think that's the move from this year's report to next year's report. this year is an amalgamation of the best successful case studies from around the world. Next year's report will be a more systematic review of common guidelines, common checklists, methodology of how to succeed, at least in positive education. I think analogous systematic reviews can be done in health and smart cities and other chapters.
Since you've been through a number of projects and demonstrations, what would you say, putting you a little bit on the spot, to an education minister, okay, I want to get started, what should I do?
Alejandro has quite a bit of experience.
I know.
Good, Alejandro. You are putting me on the spot, but I've had these conversations with ministers before. Number one is measurement. You can only change what you measure, and what you measure really, to a great extent, guides the discourse at the public policy level, particularly, and it's the only way to evaluate impact. Number two is choose the most enabling district, state, municipality, whatever level you're willing and able to work at to have a proof of concept. Have evidence-based but culturally adapted training for principals and teachers, first and foremost, avoiding the temptation of going directly to students. Teachers and principals have to learn and live the skills of well-being before they can teach and embed them. And then finally, have ongoing teacher training and evaluation. And have that's in short, what we learned.
Well, Alejandro's being over modest here. Best research on the question of positive education and the objection we generally run into is that budgets for schools are a zero-sum game. So if you want to teach kids about happiness, you're going to omit geometry, you're going to omit music. And so the question of synergy became important. And so Alejandro's data, which I'll talk about tonight, involving in this most recent 694,000 kids in Peru in 700 schools, is that when you teach positive education, the national standardized exams get better compared to controls that don't have it. So one message to ministers of education, it's win-win, that it doesn't subtract from your normal goals, it adds to it.
Yeah. Richard, let me put you back on the spot again. Just to say, what would you say to a health minister in next year's report about how to get started on scaling up mental health interventions?
Which would consist of
identifying
which treatments you want to have available to what populations, over what time period, then how many people you can train feasibly to a decent quality, no point just rushing ahead, achieve the quality standards year by year, build up year by year, and then make sure that you have some system of organizing the delivery, which sustains quality, proper supervision, and so on. Obviously, what you say to different health ministers in different countries differs, because in richer countries you are after a full professionalization of the mental health workforce. With, for example, in the program you have in Britain, all the people who are trained have had not only at least some time working in some other capacity with mental health problems, but 1 year's specific training in having a psychological therapy. In poorer countries, the people who have worked on this most have come to the conclusion that you probably have to go more for sub-professional rehab, even for general health care workers. I have wrote a few doubts about this, but the recommendation that's made from the WHO is sub-professionals take general health care workers, give them a decent dose of training time to administer psychosocial treatments to people in the field. Personally, I would always want to stress that the importance of professionals, and at least having a decent cadre of professional mental health professionals in every country, however small, I think otherwise we're not going to ever get to where we want to get to.
I'm just testing the theme of whether we like the approach that the difference of presenting case studies from what we're talking about here is how you actually get started. And you can use a case study in a different way rather than reporting, Peru did this, here's how it did it. It started this way, it went on to this, Then in the first year it had 20 schools, in the second year 200 schools, in the third year 1,000 schools. It allocated this budget, it made this task force, it planned for this. So you can still do case studies, but it's a different kind of purpose. It's not talking about the results, it's talking about the process of how you actually do this. So that's the theme that I find a good one, actually, for the report, to move this forward, is that it's a very operational approach. So you would find cases of scaling up that you want to highlight. Look, this was done in such and such place. It's not impossible. Within 3 years, there was a national program put in place. Here's what they did. Here are the lessons from it. Here's a box from the minister who actually did it with some guidance for colleagues. That kind of chapter. Yeah?
Sure, but 10 years rather than three.
Or 10 years rather than three, whatever it is. I'm not making the prescription.
I want to add an arrow into your quiver, which blends positive education and health. So in my contact with the National Health Service in the UK, as you know, the minister and people are worrying about burnout. There's a huge amount of burnout in NHS. Well, we know something about the relationship of happiness to burnout, that the procedures that build happiness promptly counter burnout. So it's another arrow in your quiver. And when you do that, I think it's not just that you get better retention of healthcare workers, but wouldn't surprise me if health outcomes in the patients are better with happy healthcare workers.
I agree. I mean, it's quite interesting that the psychological therapy service we set up in Britain has got the lowest turnover of any category of medical staff. And this is because, led by clinical psychologists, there's a clinical lead who's critical and has
great independence. Great. Yeah.
I want to take the opportunity to thank first and foremost the members of my Workplace Happiness Committee for their time and the feedback that they've given throughout the last 6 months. So thank you all. And quite a few of my committee are here today as well. So that's very nice of you. And thank you for that. We took advantage of the opportunity for the first report to really focus on the very basics, a little bit of an empirical and solid foundation for the future chapters. And so what we did is answer the very simple but important question of just how important is work for well-being. And we made, which to no surprise to most of you, the response is obvious. I think that the importance of work is health and education. And I'll show you some of the data this afternoon. We then also, needless to say, looked into the global data on employee engagement and job satisfaction, and we looked into just what drivers, what job characteristics are most conducive to well-being, which led to our recommendations in the report that we'll talk about that this afternoon. What we did not do this time around, and what we're hoping to do for the next report, if you'll agree, is to make the business case to business leaders and senior organization leaders for why it is such a clever and smart idea to put well-being at the heart of their business or organization. So we've actually come consciously left this out of this report, in this name, some of the commentators on the report, on our chapter. But they gave such a nice, brewing literature with solid evidence for why well-being actually matters 2 months bottom line. And so what I want to explore with my committee this coming year is, how does this impact the recruitment of people? How does it impact the motivation of people on the job? How does it impact retention of people? And there, I think, what the current evidence is currently pointing to is that that's where most money, quote unquote, is made for organizations, is that happier workplaces retain people longer. And there's evidence that every senior person to be replaced, or a high school person, is a cost of about $20,000 to find a good person, train that person to perform well in their job. So higher retention rates are something important to aspire to. So that, plus not just how employees do better in terms of productivity and performance and downline customer satisfaction, which I know one of the members of our committee, Paul Litchfield, is always focusing in on, it's not just employee productivity, it's also customer satisfaction down the line. And there's some research in that that is coming along, and we're hoping to integrate that into the chapter. There's also some more macro evidence around, or for the business case, for why putting well-being at the heart of the workplace is worthwhile, and that is looking at the stock markets and how companies doing quarterly reports subsequent. And so here, the real opportunity for our committee is to work with somebody who's on the committee, who's not here today, is Jim Harder, who's the chief scientist of Gallup, an expert in workplace well-being. And some of us in the room have the great opportunity to have access to the Gallup World Poll, even Daily Poll. But what we do not have access to, Marty, is the actual company data set. So Gallup's business is to survey and do in-house, in-company survey. And they have hundreds and millions of survey responses by employees in these companies on all kinds of what they call the Q12, so employee engagement measures. If we use that data, imagine with the public reference data on quarterly reports or how they do in the stock market subsequently, we can start linking how a company is doing and how much they care about workplace well-being with how they do objectively in, say, the quarterly reports following, obviously, the measurement in well-being. Because we don't really want to try and get away from personal health as much as we can. So I think we have the real opportunity to make a practical business case as leaders of organizations in the private sector or public sector for why it is a good idea to do so after this year kind of data and internal foundations for why it matters. I think
what's known about interventions?
Yeah. So out of this year's report's work, the results indicate sort of four major recommendations that we've put into the chapter that we've developed with two major case studies that we lay out and we propose recommend everybody to use. One is the Upskill program that John kindly suggested to us. And provides it's a Canadian program. It talks about essential skills in the workplace. Because as it turns out, this is something that was actually quite new to me, for most people, on the job is the best opportunity to still get educated and skilled. A lot of people in the workplace do not have more than a high school education, but they will spend the next 30, 40 years at work. So that's where essential skills, such as literacy, which is the essence of the Upskill program, can still be taught. And the long-term impact of that is really important. So this is something that I had overlooked way back, and that thanks to this program, we've put forward. Another program is one that Richard has been pushing really hard for all good reasons, which is called the STAR program, which is run out more globally and has been tested by the super and are the most solid evidence-based RCT, randomized control trial evidence. So they are the best programs that we know. The STAR program, what it does is provide for more autonomy and train managers to be more supportive and think of ways of giving autonomy to the people that they're in charge of, and with wonderful impact on well-being and performance. So these are a number of recommendations that have come out of the research, and we've got these two programs that we're putting up there as the benchmarks of the best programs that have been properly validated.
Great.
Thank you, and Jeff, unless I'm mistaken, I think the vision of this commission is really to bring about a paradigm shift, a revolution in the role that governments see themselves as fulfilling. as increasing the tonnage of well-being in their constituents. And more than just systematizing common ingredients of success stories within sectors, my suggestion is to break silos and find common ingredients across sectors. And I'm hearing in health, in business, and education, common ingredients, number one, rigorous measurements. Number two, evidence-based interventions, particularly training around skills rather than knowledge, skills-based training. And number three, the fact that well-being and whatever the traditional bottom lines are not just not mutually exclusive, they're mutually reinforcing. So well-being increases academic performance. Well-being enhances physical health. Well-being increases productivity. And I think that will really galvanize political will to bring about well-being as an umbrella guiding compass rather than compartmentalized within sector, rather than between sector, and redefine the role of government.
You know, maybe this is for John, but cutting across is that people vote well-being. So I think it's worth, Daniel, telling people about your data and some of our data on voters voting well-being, and that's something that cuts across. Maybe we should have a chapter.
You okay with that, Jeff? So what Marty and I are thinking about a lot in Thursday these days is, if they actually pay for politicians to care about well-being, so it's not just the right thing to do, it's also the clever political thing to do. And the way that we've come across this is, in no small part, thanks to George, who's with us here today, we started delving into the Eurobarometer data and looking at all the European elections since about the 70s to find that the incumbent governments have a higher chance of re-election if they've actually been able to improve well-being. That may not come as much of a surprise, but what may come as a surprise is that it does better than economic variables in predicting the electoral outcomes of this. So what we in economics and political science think of as the economic voting literature, which is thousands of books and pages of journals, is about how unemployment, inflation, and growth are supposedly the driving forces for getting elected and doing well as a politician. Turns out that well-being tends to do something better than that. What Mark and I are specifically thinking of is our the person in the White House who will not be named. What we find is, through very granular data in the US, the biggest explanatory driver wasn't race or economics. It was a drop in well-being in these districts and counties in the US. It's the best possible explanatory for this particular Trump story. And so George, again, is working really hard on this as well, and this should be coming out very shortly. So there is a political incentive, and I mean, to also tie this in with what you're saying, this notion that well-being has objective benefits to it, whether it's really across the whole basis of the spectrum, as well as political dividends that can be paid out to politicians, is something that I think will help motivate. Now, I do want to make one point that we've made very clear at the beginning of the World Happiness Report chapter 8 years ago, called the objective benefits of subjective well-being. We need to be careful to not instrumentalize well-being, because what you're saying is kind of putting it back in the term, is putting well-being back on its head, because it would mean that we're looking at moving well-being upwards for the sake of doing well and productivity, for the sake of being healthier. But ultimately, all of these are meant to be for the sake of well-being. But I think for the sake of convincing politicians and policymakers, it's worthwhile doing this, always keeping the back of your mind that it ought not be, well-being is not to be instrumentalized, it's meant to be more on that front.
It's both, right? It's the intrinsic and the instrumental values of well-being. But it's hard to convince, and I've dealt with a lot of ministers of education, to care about well-being for its intrinsic value. When you can show the instrumental value that translates into higher PISA scores, then they suddenly love well-being. But, you know, it's a win-win. As long as you don't destroy the environment with, you know, the GDP going off the roof.
Robert?
You know that I'm not Ed Diener, but I'm Robert Ed Gordon Diener, so I'm as close as you're likely to get today. My father sends his regrets to you and wants to thank those of you who worked on our committee and chapter as well. We are the personal happiness working group, and so it might come as a surprise that we did not write much about personal happiness in our chapter. We actually tinkered for a long time thinking about the classic happiness interventions, and we decided that they seemed, at least at first blush, far afield from the purview of government policy. And we chose instead to focus on a list of social well-being variables, because I think most people in positive psychology circles would agree that to the extent that there is a secret to happiness, it is to be found in our relationships. So we tried to look at variables that were associated with well-being, for which there was research literature, for which there were at least decent case studies that we could point to, and that seemed to be relevant to policy and policy makers. So those were our criteria for inclusion. And we chose three very broad, abstract, sort of social themes. They were connection, trust, and safety. And you'll find, if you bother to read our chapter, that there will be some overlap with some of the other chapters because of that, because these themes are, as Alejandro says, so cross-cutting. For example, in connection, urban design is one obvious way, and so when folks talk about happy cities, all sorts of engaged programs that will not be unfamiliar to policymakers, like pedestrian walkways and lower speed limits and green space development, are fantastic ways to promote connection, are associated with well-being, and exist in two chapters in this book. We've also looked at trust, and this is one of the most interesting aspects, I think, because the idea that the government has a very serious obligation to get rid of nepotism, cronyism, corruption in all forms, has a trickle-down effect to the citizenry. This is very different than the idea that we will just educate individual citizens, which is, of course, a worthwhile goal, and make them happy. But if you just create a trustworthy society, a trustworthy government, that also, in aggregate, will make people happy without having to do any individual intervention. And I think that is worth noting. And then safety, of course, this is good infrastructure, policing, emergency services. So one of the things I personally liked a little bit about that element was the idea that there is, I think, what we would think of as negative talk with positive talk. I'm not that Pollyanna a person. I can be quite critical of things. And I think it's remiss in some ways to say, let's just capitalize on success, let's just build on happiness while people are being abused and exploited. So I think to the extent that governments can create safety by stopping abuse and preventing exploitation at the same time as we help connect people and engage people in safety and trust, that is, I think, a laudable goal. And that is our challenge.
What do you think about next year?
That's a great question. I'm going to actually let John answer it. Do you have a prepared answer? Because I know from being a fly on the wall that you and my father have emailed a bunch about this, so hopefully you do have an answer.
Well, the email that we've exchanged had more to do with something that was in our minds as we saw what we had done this year as an inventory of what existed. And then we were nervous about declaring very many of them as best practices. Because we said, you know, the evidentiary base of a lot of this stuff is really not what we as scientists would say is enough to say I could sign off on this. So we were going to raise the evidentiary bar next year and say, okay, we're sending all this out to bigger communities, we're getting more and more examples back. Let's look at them with a little flintier eye, and then choose the ones that really do pass muster, and then call some of them best practices. Now that's the kind of emails that we've been exchanging up till now, but you see we're in a new tack from yesterday. Well, I haven't gotten an email with him since yesterday, so I don't know. My guess is see rather like this twist that we're taking now, which is saying, all right, while at the same time looking for more solid evidence, let's actually find a more complete recipe. So it's not enough just to say something seemed to work. Let's say, what would you give to the cook and say, take this, and this will give you grounds to actually do something that will work. There's one in the previous examples have all spoken to that. Now, I'll bet you could, on the fly, think of how you might do it in a personal space. There's a lot of stuff you would draw on to do that. There's one more thing we talked about yesterday that hasn't got into today's discussion. You might ask other chapters in general discussion to think about, is that there's always a tendency to celebrate and describe the odd super success. What the world is very short of is honest feedback on things that didn't work. Because there's a lot of lessons to be learned, and a lot of people are not reinventing the wheel, they're reinventing the traffic accident because they didn't learn about what caused the last one, so they didn't stop the current one. And there's one more element of that that Martine will probably address, and she did yesterday, which is how about looking at, and in this year's chapter indeed, what are the blockages? Because if we're trying to focus efforts on making a kitchen that works, you want to be able to say, well, I know standard things that happen that pot handle falls off, and so you need the tools to fix that. So one of the things those who made things work have learned is some of the things that can go wrong on the way out to the product showroom and how to fix them. And it may be at the same time exposing topics for a subsequent report, which is here are some generalized roadblocks in the political system, in the information system, or in the training system that might go on. I thought too long. I think we're on to cities now. Ali, are you speaking? You want to go?
So let me introduce myself to those who don't know me. My name is Aisha Bishop. I live at Smart City Project in Dubai, and I'm leading the Happy Cities team. Well, at the beginning, we faced a bit of, we weren't really ready to select what type of methods we need to structure our discussion in our team. With the support of the sub-council members like Scott, Dr. Ali, and some other are here, we decided, okay, let us first decide this report will go to whom? Who are our audience? Okay, city managers, because it's about cities, and we want to convince cities who will implement projects around happiness, so let us put it in a pragmatic way that they can understand it. That's why we've selected a framework which is known for cities, like the different sectors of cities, economy, living, environment, community, government, people, and we shape the whole content around those sectors. But again, when we sat in New York last time, we found that there are a lot of similarity between topics that we want to discuss in our theme. And the topics are already discussed on other things. Education, health, work, personal. So where to draw the line? And how the audience will perceive this report? If there is a lot of similarities and there isn't any like a proper structure for the whole report, but we thought this is your duty, John, it's not our duty, let us put our content there. Anyway, we find many great examples globally, and we're talking about how to pursue government. We need to show them those examples that other cities manage to implement with less financing to promote happiness, not necessarily with big budgets, as long as they know what they want to achieve. Making sure that there is some data in these cities, building trust, and make sure that these projects also promote inclusivity in their objective. And again, thinking about what around 32 use cases being like mapped, and our report I'm not sharing was like this is too long, 26,000 words. We decided we told it is only 10,000. But it was a shame not to put all these use cases to share it with the audience who would read that report. But going forward, I believe if we have a proper framework, a systematic approach to all this content that we want to fill our reports with, something like a matrix wherein each one of us as a team will go and put this content in. We talked about data. All of us talk about data. So why not have a proper component that we can publish use cases around data, use cases around trust, use cases around inclusivity, tools. All of us talk about tools. How we can combine these tools also in a proper structure that the reader can use it and utilize it properly. And I believe that we can add a lot to the literature, especially the practical literature that city managers can take and implement. Today, I'm a city manager here in Dubai. I would love to see somewhere a toolkit, a representative of a successful project that I can go back home and implement it. Yes, I would really tailor it, but at least something properly documented and supervised by academic people like you here. My last point would be, we want to utilize this report, as you said, Jeff. There are many opportunities and problems, but I would love to see if there is any branding, a media kit, a template that we can take with us today and start promoting for the existing
So let me just say one word about that. The launch, public launch, will be this Thursday. By Tuesday, you will have press release, website, and ideas and encouragement for you, for your social media, for Twitter, and your other accounts, and for blogging about this. And we will develop together a calendar of events for the year in which we can participate. So all of that is very well taken. We'll make sure that that the report gets out.
And also I want to emphasize on something you were talking about yesterday, an offer that we can put it in a proper, systematic way, how we can offer others to utilize
yes.
the findings, not only from the city, Happy Cities team, but from the rest teams. What would be that offer that we will give it to government, to utilize governments to utilize the findings?
Yeah, very good. Please.
Hi, I'm Scott, so I'm contributing to the city chapter. The point about yep. zero-sum game struck me, a point about adjacency. So, an earlier part of my career, we looked at public policy to do with entrepreneurship. We did some work with the Kauffman Foundation, which may be familiar to some of the US colleagues. And there was a couple of things that we did, this is about 10, 12 years ago, that I think may be applicable here. So, we had to do the exact same thing. We had to persuade finance ministers, education ministers and others that entrepreneurship wouldn't be a distraction from other forms of learning or you know, policy efforts, and instead would enhance education, would enhance the economy and so forth. And over, I think, probably about a period of 4 years, we then sought to then establish some properties, which I think you already have in the happiness world. But there's, so there was a summit, which already exists. Then became the Global Entrepreneurship Index, there was then something called a Global Entrepreneurship Research Network. I don't know if there's an equivalent research network, probably is already. But there was these things have then enabled over a 10-year cycle for these things to get entwined with each other, so that they seem to build. So instead of feeling like you're pulling things in slightly different directions, they feel like they build over the course of the calendar year and over the course of multiple years to turn out to each other. And then the second point, again, to do with adjacency, which is from an urban perspective. It strikes us that in an era of metro mayors, so lots of things that sort of devolved rapidly from a national government or sort of metro area, that they're typically doing so with smaller budgets, but they're having to deal with their more complex topics in place. And so if you're dealing with public service reform, you may be seeking to the greatest cost of adult social care, but your budget is for transport. It's then about how you can use mobility options and transport options to deliver better health outcomes. And so it strikes me that when thinking across the topics that you've got in this first document, there may be some others that could be used as leverage to then deliver across each of the areas. So for example, if you're looking at mobility, active travel delivers health outcomes, therefore there's a mobility element, but it's also a health issue. It may not really be in there, but I've not really had a chance to read it yet. But just a couple of thoughts.
Thank you, Jeff. I'm sorry, I lost my voice. I was in the US. So this year our chapter is about metric and evaluation. So again, we didn't describe only sort of metrics and so on, but actually how these metrics are being used in policy. So the chapter starts by describing what countries have been doing at the national level. Okay, so we're not looking at central level, but really what national government, whole of government, Minister for Happiness here talks about the whole of happiness. We looked at the whole of government perspective on well-being and whether they've developed frameworks to actually look at this whole of government perspective. And so we describe experiences in mainly OECD countries about countries which have developed such frameworks and sort of metrics that they are using to measure well-being. And we also document very concretely what the role of subjective well-being, so happiness, plays in those frameworks. Because it's fair to say that, I mean, we have to say, as John mentioned, what works, what doesn't work, that while we all for happiness, many governments at the national government level still find that as a very, very, very difficult agenda. I have to put a sort of notion of a reality check here. While they all talk about well-being, and I will say that this afternoon, they see that more as a multidimensional concept, where they have, like in the personal well-being, they look at the determinants perhaps, but they go back to the what they know best. And when you tell them happiness is the ultimate objective and that's what you should be doing, you see a lot of kind of resistance about it. So we're not there yet. And we have to recognize this. We should not be naive. This is how government think these days. Okay. So we document this. We also document how this, once they have developed these indicators, where has the initiative been coming from? Sometimes the initiative has come from simply statistical offices who have looked at the future and enlarged their indicator set so that you have a better diagnosis of the situation of people in the country. And here we have Enrico Giovannini, who's done that for Italy, when he was the president of ISTAT, and so on. Then the next move is whether this has been picked up by policymakers in policy to change the way that they are making policy, and we document it. So we look at the measurement frameworks for about 22 countries. Then we look at countries that have actually designed a policy framework based on using these indicators, and where in policy this is affecting the policy cycle, if you wish, whether they use this for diagnosis, identifying priorities, whether they use it actually for doing ex-ante cost analysis benefits, whether they're doing it as a monitoring, what they do, they do policies every day. Does it change something, and can you measure with this indicator set? Whether they do it is ex-post evaluation, once they've done an intervention, has it had an impact, and they have this metric, they use this metric, and it varies across countries. Some countries stop at the diagnosis. Some use it really at the implementation phase. Some at the monitoring phase. Some do cost-benefit analysis, ex-ante, impact assessment, if you wish. So this is very varied, and we document about 10 countries that are actually doing it. And then we go in depth in 7 case studies to understand what works, what doesn't. Because even in the countries with all goodwill, they're not getting there, you know. Let me give you the example of my own country, France. A law has been passed at the initiative of Parliament to actually have this sort of ex-ante assessment during, presented to Parliament during a budgetary discussion to influence what Parliament would actually vote as allocation of resources for such or such interventions, okay? So, in principle, they're obliged, the government is compulsory for the government to present a report to say, I'm proposing this intervention, and here's what the impact will be on these different types of indicators, well-being indicators, and so the parliament can then decide whether, you know, that there are trade-offs, so they decide on the budget allocation. And so they're supposed to do it every year at the start of the budgetary discussion. By law, the 2017 report has still not been published, okay, despite the fact that there is a law. All right. In Italy, it's about the same process that is being implemented, and it, hopefully the Parliament, the Senate, will actually review this and will indeed then move all the way forward, but they're not actually done yet.
This week.
So we hope that it's going to be the star and the star country and the best practice. But this, we're not there yet because it's not started. But Parliament and government also want to move forward. It's not just today's well-being, it's also future well-being and what it will impact, I mean, what will it impact for the future. So they want to be able to make projections about if they do something today, will it have an impact tomorrow, the year after tomorrow, and so on. And this is where subjective well-being becomes very complicated, because it's very difficult to make projections of happiness in the future. Hence, in Italy, despite the fact that they have developed a set of indicators where subjective well-being figures highly, they deleted it from the set of indicators that Parliament is actually going to use. All this to say that for next year, so that's what we document for this year, okay? The experience, really, really concrete experience, at the whole of government level. For next year, what we want to do is to actually analyze in greater detail those blockages. What is it that prevents this agenda to be adopted by governments? Is there some particular reluctance in relying on happiness indicators because they feel that those are still not solid enough in terms of their validity, statistical validity, and more work needs to be done there? I don't think, frankly, that this is the main reason, because I think now there is all the evidence that you can level out the work that CARE in particular has done with the guidance of subjective learning at the UCD shows that we can, you know, have sufficient confidence in that. I think it's more the fact that they find it extremely you know, they're not convinced, so we need to understand why this is the case. So next year we would like to analyze in much greater detail what are the constraints, what are the blockages. And then I have also come up with tools, be concrete, tell them how to do it based on some good practices that we see. So we'd like to see, to draw on the experiences from the other chapters and say, here are some tools of cost-benefit analysis. For instance, at UCD, we've done a lot of work on regulatory impact analysis, which is based not on just economic benefits, but also in terms of well-being at the city level. There are many things that are concrete tools so that we can move the agenda forward. So that would be moving our agenda from the metrics to the policy use and what, so to one, what are the constraints, to can we come up with some tools that can be used, as you mentioned, across sectors and break the silos. Because if you go only, or else we say, this is an agenda for very specific interventions, but it's not an agenda for the whole program. And perhaps, I don't have the answer, and I don't know, we need to talk to practitioners more, properly to make sure that we have an answer. But if we want to be optimistic, and let's say that this is an agenda at whole government level, then we really need to understand what are the constraints, and we need to provide answers and provide to that action work and convince the governments and the politicians. So what we really want to do also is to organize meetings at the UCD with, as we put it yesterday during our brainstorming session, with the bureaucrats. Not necessarily the policy makers, because you can have a very enlightened leader who will say, oh yes, and I'm all for it, but how the machinery of government make it possible or not. Because you mentioned that at the business sector, it's the intermediate level managers or you that need to be targeted. But at the level of government, it's the same. It's a bureaucrat that are in the administration, and they know that in 4 years or 5 years the government will change, and so why would they care about this new government who tells you to do that? Because anyway, next government will have other ideas. Okay? So how to target those bureaucrats and change their behavior? And I think that's where we need to also understand a little bit more what's happening there. So that's what we'd like to do.
Thank you, Enrico Giovannini. I had the privilege to be involved by John in reading the policy chapter, the synthesis, and I was late in sending my comments to him, so I'm sorry for that. But let me bring to you, I would say, four fundamental questions that I think this initiative should try to address. The first one, if you say sustainable development to most people, they think about an environmental agenda. Now, with the SDGs and so on, we are trying to make an effort to integrate everything together. But if you talk about happiness agenda, do they see the relationships with other agendas like SDGs or their own agendas, or they think that this is something esoteric that doesn't have the connections to health and patient and all the others. As Martin said, if you try to speak about your analytical results to specific ministers, they may listen to you. But if you say happiness agenda, it's very difficult to say. Now, the key point is, as the rest of the world now has embraced, also thanks to Jeff's efforts, the sustainable development agenda, and they do not understand the relationships between the happiness agenda and the SDGs, it's very difficult to sell this new agenda, which is seen as paradigm. Unless you resolve this from a political, from a communication, and from an analytical perspective, it's very complicated to compete with the SDGs. As you remember, in Bhutan, we tried to do that years ago. And I think that the next year report should be clearly fleshed out how these different agendas fit together and what is the role of this agenda in the global agenda. As I said, it's not an easy, I try to do that, but you have to do this. Second point, you have the same problem on statistics. Because now the countries are fully engaged and busy with the development of SDGs indicators. And the subjective well-being indicators, unfortunately, are not included in the set of SDGs indicators. Here, you may have a window of opportunity. If, Martin, please correct me if I'm wrong, but in 2020, there should be a sort of revision of indicators that were selected in 2016. So you have, we have, let's say, a little bit more, 1 year to go to advocate this, but this will enter into the SDGs only if you demonstrate that these ideas have something to do with SDGs. Third point. Uh, In October 2018, there will be the OECD World Forum.
November,
sorry. And in October here in Dubai, there will be the World Data Forum, which is managed by UN. Difficult to find a slot about happiness, but also by the government of Dubai. And as we heard, they could eventually push for discussion on these issues because they manage part of the agenda. So I would recommend to include in Jeff's list of events this year, these particular two meetings where a window of opportunity could emerge. But then there will be also the report by Martin, Joe, and the others of the Stiglitz Group Commission, where these kind of issues are discussed. So again, and this will be done at the OECD Forum, if I'm not wrong, Martin, in November. So again, this is another opportunity to be added to the list that Jeff made. Very last remark. And this is related to my experience in Italy to sell. By the way, it looks like this Thursday the government will release their ex post report. In a nutshell, what Italy now has to do in by law, in April, when the economic planning and financial planning at European level has to be done, they have to make the analysis of the last 3 years' trends of 12 out of 130 well-being indicators and make the projections for the following 3 years. And after the budget law is adopted in December, by February, they have to do another paper showing how the actual decisions are going to impact of the next 3 years on well-being indicators. But as you said, when we had to select the 12 indicators out of 130, the members of the committee said, how can we make forecasts of subjective well-being indicators? We discussed this for a long time, but then we ended with 12 indicators that do not include the subjective indicators. Also because the government has to develop models to do that, and frankly speaking, is not an easy task at my level. So the point I would like to make is, again, who should be the champion at national level for having this kind of improvement? In Italy, we were able to do it with the Minister of Finance, the former Deputy Secretary General of the OECD and old friend, but also someone in the Parliament, the head of the Budget Committee, who was very much exposed to these kind of things. And finally, he put his face on the proposal, saying, okay, if you do not accept that to the government, I will not sign the proposal for the budget. A little bit strong. So you need to target this. Is the Prime Minister? Is the Minister of Finance? Is the Minister of Environment? Who can take this forward? Are individual ministers or are the prime minister? And in this case, you face the field. Last point. I know that there is an attempt to try to build the H7 or W7, which is the happiness G7 or the well-being G7. Lorenzo Ferramonti tried to do that when he was, now he's running for that he was trying to do that. That is an idea that maybe could work. Not easy. But you need to find a small group of real champions at world level who can be vocal on this, not only in meetings, but trying to do. So if you wish, I can try to get it happen.
All right, all you happiness gurus. Here are the 10 least happy countries in the world last year. Yemen, South Sudan, Liberia, Guinea, Togo, Rwanda, Syria, Tanzania, Burundi, and Central African Republic.
and Richard's Benthamite principles, I'm sure that the highest returns of global well-being per dollar would be to raise the well-being of these countries. Certainly, they're the most extreme negative examples, and they must be two standard deviations or three standard deviations below the global average. Think about it. Are we ready to raise the happiness in Syria? What could we do? What could we do in maybe an easier case, if you want an easier case, is Liberia. Just has a new president. It's not at war. It is seventh from the bottom of last year's list. We'll have a new list in 4 weeks. I think as a provocation, as a group, we ought to take on this challenge. And I'm happy to write on behalf of us to the heads of state of the bottom 10 countries and tell them that they're the bottom 10. And that there's a group of world experts on well-being that would be happy to consult with them if they're interested. And see what they say. If they are interested, you gotta come. It's not so safe to visit Sana'a right now. It's not so safe to visit Damascus. There are reasons for unhappiness that are we talked about yesterday a little bit. But I think I'm making this as a semi-serious proposition. Any thoughts on this?
Yeah. So my immediate thought on that is to go just above the bottom 10.
Is what?
Is to go just above the bottom 10.
I can't hear you.
Go above the bottom 10, no. So just above them.
No, that's a dodge.
I think you could actually have a greater impact in some countries that aren't at war.
Well, what about stopping the wars? We're a happiness group.
I do think you could have a significant impact with some of the policies we've been talking about today in countries that are ready to do it. So it was about the implementation of the education ideas. It was finding places that were ready and willing to go first. And we've seen that in the workplace as well. So where implementation has been really effective is we've been working with areas that are really keen to go as well as needing immediate action.
I'm unhappy about wars. Why don't we...
not saying we don't need to, but I think in terms of having been able to get successes quickly, we might be.
Well, any wars can be very quick. It's cheap. You actually save a lot of money. It can stop from one day to the next. The intervention could probably raise more happiness in a moment to stop the bombing in Syria. That could be the biggest, cheapest intervention at huge savings. And a huge boost of well-being. So I don't want to give up on this list yet. Yeah.
Sure. Well, at least empirically, we've worked with 12 countries at this point. And we see a bell curve in terms of income per capita on the horizontal axis and change in well-being on the vertical axis, where least developed countries, public policy interventions, what public policy? There is no rule of law. What education? What healthcare? What business sector? Right? It's middle-income countries where we really have the most bang per buck for these kinds of public policy interventions. The ones in this report, Finland, Denmark, so on. There are ceiling effects, right? So that's where you also go down. They're already 8, 9 out of 10. So if you wanted to raise happiness while being in the bottom 10 most countries, give them food, shelter, housing, safety. But I think that's beyond the scope of this report, which is public policy recommendations.
That's a common policy recommendation.
It's an international policy recommendation, sure, World Bank direct formal foreign aid, but national public policy?
No,
we don't have to do the limit search.
I just have a quick question. Actually, I have a couple. So when you talk about the Minister of Finance as the go-to for bringing happiness, I guess, into a country, I'm a Canadian working with the Canadian government, lobbying the Canadian government. Actually, we have a meeting with them on the 28th of February to talk about creating a happiness council, which is a really good step forward for this country. This is Canada.
Canada.
Yes, so, and so we finally made progress after a couple of years of working with them. They have a well-being policy, but it needs to fit somewhere. And so when you mentioned the Minister of Finance there, when we found the sort of that barrier to creating the full council, what we found is, where does it fit? You know, does it fit into health? Does it fit into finance? So we're meeting with all of the, sort of the ministers to decide that, Chrystia Freeland and Minister of Ed, even education, figuring that out. So one of the ways that we started to try to create, remove the roadblocks, was to measure various areas within the government, like public health, measuring education, understanding how interventions actually play out in outcomes. So are you measuring the outcomes of the impact of wellness, of happiness, through financial measurements? And if there is an opportunity, this is the second part of the question, if there is an opportunity for us to move forward within the Canadian Council and create this Happiness Council or Minister of Happiness, because Trudeau actually does have the autonomy to select three ministers and can choose a Minister of Happiness should he choose to do so, would we be able to call on the leads to come and have those conversations with him? You know, can we pull folks in to be able to come into these meetings? How do we get access to some of these leads that can answer these questions when we need them? Because that would pull a lot of weight if we could bring them into these types of opportunities.
Okay, I want to come back to the bottom 10. Thanks, but we'll answer that. But before we get to Canada, I want better answers from this group.
Let
me say why. Because if the answer is, well, it's just development, then, okay, we're not adding anything to a lot of the world. I'd be pretty disappointed if the answer is, well, they're poor, so there's not much to do. That doesn't seem to me to be very, very right answer, by the way. If the answer is, it's war, seems to me this group should have a lot to say about that. Maybe it's not your particular expertise, but that's actually not about resources. That's about ideas, that's about hatred, that's about in-groups and out-groups, that's about misunderstandings. That's actually not resources. That's craziness, which I think it is, by the way. But then, that's a different matter. That should be the lowest hanging fruit in the world, is to stop these wars. And what's stopping that? What are the structural problems? Why is there so much unhappiness? That societies are being destroyed for no obvious reason. Or for reasons I mentioned yesterday, which are real reasons, they're structural. They require an explanation as well. So I don't want us to leave this topic yet, because it seems to me a real issue. Of course, there's more refined, many, many good things to do in less difficult places. But these are very unhappy places. And I just wonder whether the happiness community can say something about the most unhappy places, something useful. So I'm continuing the challenge. Yeah.
I'm not part of the council.
Let's go to the council first, and then.
Yes. I was going to say similar to what you just said, to answer your own question, which is it depends on the expertise that's in the panel. So it may well be those hanging fruit, but if you don't have that expertise or wisdom or skills, whatever you want to call it, to actually address those hanging fruit, then we're just going to be wasting what we could do. So I understood that the reason why we have segmented the report in the domains that we have is because we've got these particular expertise really in-house. So if you're suggesting that we should sort of co-opt other expertise to deal with how to persuade people that bombing people, killing them is not a good idea, you've got a better way to win your life, whatever that metric is for them, then this is a different skill set to a health expert or an educationalist. So what I'm trying to say is a different question. Should we augment our expertise rather than should we just retool? I don't think we've got that tool system right now, so that's the other problem.
Thank you. At least five of the countries we've been there are post-conflict countries. Post-conflict, so it means the war is over.
Yeah.
So I work with post-conflict countries, and I found that this is a unique opportunity for us to go and help with new policies. And they are hungry for new policies. It's actually easier to teach them about new policies, especially if they are post-conflict countries, because they want to change. You know, so they don't want to go back to the previous reasons why they are born. So we have Liberia in Miami, by the way, and probably Southern Sudan as well. And probably other ones that you mentioned, maybe another one or two, you need to be at our event in Miami. They're interesting to find this, by the way. And the budgets. And the budgets. So actually the same coincidence. They're going to be in Miami at our peace and meeting. Post-conflict is actually, you have less resistance in post-conflict countries than you would have in developing countries.
I was just giving my agreement to that and wanted to reinforce how much I liked that comment. I'm wary of the current concepts. Countries only because I think war interferes with the effectiveness of programs that might otherwise be delivered to the populace, but many of these countries are not actively at war, many of them aren't post-conflict. I see loads of potential here, and I think it is neither waste of our expertise nor is the fact that it's poverty or may even just be a form of development. A compelling rationale not to do it. I'm very intrigued and inspired by this notion.
Could we look at, suggesting that maybe we look at creating a bit of a tipping point with some of the low-hanging fruit countries like Canada and see if there's a way for us to have a dual role where they're participating in not only sponsoring the happiness of their own country, but then also participating in maybe tackling a one-for-one or B Corp model where every country has another country that they co-sponsor in developing their well-being as well, and figure out a way to have economic development inside of our own countries and then also help another. Maybe we can look at some budget that way.
Beside the provocation by Jeff, which is, I think, I like it, but it's not excluding, let's say, the other pathway, because I think that what you said about Canada is really very encouraging, especially because Canada is chairing the G7. And don't forget what is happening in New Zealand, where the new government just announced that they want to become leaders in the management of well-being and so on and so forth. So the possibility of having a coalition of, I know that are the usual suspects, but if these countries who are implementing, have implemented, or want to implement this approach, get together, even a few of them, and try to engage a few others, that would be visible, in my view. And as far as I understood, the Canadian leader, young, very inspirational, the same for New Zealand and so on, could be exactly the right person to do that. The last remark, to address the problem of who is in charge of this agenda, the good news is that, again, linked to the SDG agenda, some ministers or some cabinet ministers, let's say, now are in charge of SDG's agenda. So, and if you decide, if we decide to link in some way the two agendas, it would make sense to address the ministers who are now in charge. This could have some benefits or some, say, cons, has to be addressed very carefully, but.
I just want to compliment what Enrico just said, or perhaps give it a different perspective. Because you mentioned New Zealand. New Zealand is a very interesting case in point. Now we have a new government in New Zealand. The new government said they want to put indeed well-being at the center, and they are revised their well-being frameworks. They, first of all, it's not called the well-being framework, that's what they should be. It's called the New Zealand Living Standards Framework. And the way they look at it is by taking what we call the capital approach, and they are forward-looking, and they say, what are the capital that we need to sustain in order to maintain the well-being or to protect the well-being of New Zealanders today and tomorrow? They identify four capitals: economic capital, natural capital,
social
capital, and
human
capital. Okay, so it's a capital approach to where, again, I think words mean something. And you're not going to have the New Zealand government, nor the minister in charge, which in New Zealand would be the treasury, so we're going to finance, having the happiness agenda. So it may have that would be very much into sustainable development, of course, the agenda, but not happiness. So words matter. And I don't think we should be careful in not grouping everything under the same umbrella, because as you said, Enrico, we need to have to make sure that these things match. And I'm concerned because I'm seeing governments coming at the OECD all the time, every day, every single day, and they talk about different things. So different things. They use different words. At the end of the day, they all, of course, agree that the ultimate objective is no longer GDP, growth, and so on, is to improve the well-being of their citizens. But the framework that they put in place is different in different countries. And what we need to do is to recognize that there are different contexts, different frameworks, different history, and so on. But there are certainly lessons to be drawn from them. And this is what we need to come up with. But keep the specificities as they are, because if you want to put everybody under the same boat, on the same boat, you risk baggage.
John, go.
Because I haven't solved all the problems, because there are still the choices to be made.
No.
There
could be.
I just want to go on a second, because of another point which some of them have, which is that, really the best way to proceed is not with. At this sort of high level of debate, but in particular instances, with particular ministers. This is not enough at all. For example, it's a major issue with a minister who's not interested in well-being, wouldn't be for a second, the one who's building the high-speed rail from London to Birmingham at a cost of 50 billion, while we're cutting all our social services and all our poverty relief. We need to be able to get that person to face up to what is the well-being benefits of what he does. Or for example, another case, we have huge housing shortages and lots of scrub land that's called Greenbelt. We have a well-being all-party committee in Parliament. We asked the chief planning officer of the Ministry of Planning, local planning. Why can't we use some of this land to build houses for people? He said, you don't understand. We have a very simple principle in this department that no community is allowed to touch any other community. This we do not allow. This is the fundamental principle. They must be kept separate. They're kept separate by this horrible bush land with no public access. These people have been challenged. Why do they think this is in the interest of the well-being of the people? So it's a general idea, not only for the people who like it, but for the people who don't like it. And I think if we go back to the history of ideas, wealth creation was never discussed in Britain anyway, much before 1960. And a small number of people, fewer than in this room, who started saying the objective of the government should be wealth creation. And by 1980, it became wealth creation. In fact, the Social Science Research Council was told in 1 year that the only purpose of social science research was to contribute to understanding of wealth creation. So these ideas are very important. We should go on plugging the big idea. But I agree with Martin, we have to find the right language. It's different in different countries. But the idea is the same. It's about the quality of life as people experience it. In some places we can call it well-being, other places we can call it quality of life, happiness. That's not the issue. But the issue is that we continue to argue for some overarching criteria as the only basis for a humane and rational policy.
Challenge, and we haven't yet fully responded to it. It seems to me we ought to be thinking about how to do it. This is a wonderful learning experience for me, what I've heard. But combining what Jeff said and Robert said, and what we've learned, what I thought I learned in the census report from the chapters this year, the importance of giving, the importance of joining personal connections, the importance of working together for a good purpose. What's wrong with looking in your chapters next year for examples that are precisely aimed? I mean, after all, one of the biggest sources of unhappiness in total is the inequality of the distribution of unhappiness. If any of these things are universally human that we're talking about, they're going to be applicable among those who are most miserable as well as the rest. And if we don't know yet how to do it, we should do it. Well, you said, well, how do you actually start in that context? I think the notion of separating conflict and post-conflict is helpful and useful. But why not set, I mean, we talk about breaking down silos, but we've been talking about breaking them down between ministries. What Jeff is saying is we must break them down across countries. So what we're doing is enabling the best of thoughts to help the people in the worst of circumstances. So how do you do that? Well, the Danish Happiness Research Institute set up a partner in Lithuania for just that purpose, that whatever they're learning, they want to make sure, and these peer-to-peer support networks, getting back to what we think we know, which is subjective well-being, these peer-to-peer support networks are very good at raising the well-being, especially of the people doing the giving. And we found that in the development area, and a whole lot of peer-to-peer things in the justice system and other, of this transfer of best practices. Well, why should we not be thinking of this specifically in well-being space? So why not, in our chapters for next year, look for cases where it isn't people applying positive education in their own schools, it's where they have chosen someone with a really difficult situation. Can they take their expertise and apply it? Once again, what is the rule book for doing it, where it has been doing well? What are the roadblocks you face? So same kind of thing we're doing, but Jeff's offered us a bigger canvas. He's saying, why can't we do this across a bigger space, a bigger distance in well-being space? Admittedly, I'm a little like some of you. In the first place, it's not our business, but it is our business. And if we can't sell it to conventional ministries, my bet is the development ministries would be one of the places who would take it on, because they see these untenable living circumstances in other countries. They have resources. They sometimes even have the capacity to take risks and make mistakes. But we need all of those in order to apply what we need.
I too have thought this provocative experiment, and I do retract myself. I think the current report is very much a compilation of the best angels of our nature, so to speak, around the world, and what works and what works well. And yesterday, Jeff, you were talking about writing a chapter on the worst demons of humanity and how to systematically avoid them, because they prevent happiness in significant and definitive ways, war, hunger, and so on and so forth. And so I think with what Robert was saying before, it would be naive to pretend that these evils do not exist. And I think a complementary chapter for next year's report would be the dark side of human nature, the bottom 10 countries, and systematically what interferes with happiness, war, famine, so on and so forth, and how to, in the same way, systematically eliminate that. So I think a healthy dialectic, underscoring the best angels of our nature in health, in education, in business, so on and so forth, but also recognizing where human nature goes wrong and how to systematically eliminate misery is necessary to really create a balanced report, not one with rose colored glasses.
Let me say just a little bit more about this. First, I'm going to write a chapter, as I said yesterday, I'm going to write a chapter about how not to do this. And there are some very clear issues about creating war, division, inequality, and so forth that are a big part of the story of unhappiness. And that's what I was emphasizing yesterday. This is not just wish fulfillment or pleasant things. There's, and by the way, it's not just poor people who tear each other up. It's rich people who bomb poor people, or who create a lot of conditions. This is not just about, all those horrible things happening in those desolate places. Syria is a war caused by the United States. So it's a very different set of issues. Okay. But I think there's more to it than this, because as was pointed out, there are a lot of these countries that are not at war. Let me give you an example. Rwanda is one of the best run countries in Africa, without question. The president is very serious. He's authoritarian. Democracy is very limited. Corruption is low. The government is well organized. It is implementing many, many important measures to get children in school, to spread electrification in the country, dramatic declines of infant mortality and maternal mortality, many, many life expectancy increases massively. Okay. Rwanda is very low on the happiness score. And interestingly, I believe it's true, to be checked, its residual is very negative. So it's not, it doesn't fit the curve. And they protested me because I work with the president. They resent this. They say the numbers must be wrong, the translations must be wrong, the data must be wrong. Maybe they are, I don't know. Somehow I doubt it. Maybe it's that there was a genocide 20 years ago, so people are not very happy. That's, by the way, that's a reality for us if that's the case. I don't know if that's the case. Who knows? We haven't studied this problem very carefully. But it's a serious government. It's an operational government. They've got the kids in school, very high enrollment rates. It's peaceful. It is experiencing economic growth. It's experiencing tremendous improvements in material condition. And it's at the bottom of the list of happiness. Do we have something to say about all of this? Maybe it's Richard, maybe it's your chapter, maybe they need mental health interventions, or maybe they need positive education, or maybe the people don't like living under a regime, even if it's very effective, don't like living under this political system. I don't know the answer to it, or maybe it's a residual that is not easily explained, or maybe it's the history of the last generation.
The Rwandan government solution to this has been to drop the Gallup World Poll.
Yeah.
Right, that's not a solution, so we haven't done it. No, the government proposed that they not be part of this. Okay, yeah, but look, this is serious business. It's a real question, and it's a real question for you, who are in this business. What's happening here? Let me give you other examples. Like Liberia is another case that is like this. We ought to be able to do something and say something serious about this. Yeah.
Well, my heart goes out to this question, but I actually disagree with Jeff.
Yeah.
So I spent the first half of my life working on misery, suicide, hopelessness, depression, anxiety, panic. And psychologists, psychology as usual, has developed a set of interventions that relieve anxiety somewhat, that relieve depression somewhat, that counter anger. But the reduction of unhappiness is not the same thing as the building of happiness. Turns out the techniques that reduce anxiety, depression, anger, the dysphorias, are about removing blockades to happiness. But the things that increase happiness, positive emotion, meaning in life, good relationships, engagement, are a different set of techniques. So I want to caution against a panacea here. From an individual psychological point of view, I think the buffering, the relief of unhappiness is a different endeavor from the building of happiness. It's different qualitatively.
But I'm not, that sounds right to me, but why does it mean that a country at the bottom of the list can't benefit from the positive happiness approach?
When I have a toothache, it preempts, a severe toothache preempts relationships, meaning, and like. So it's, I think I'm not just saying the technology of the alleviation of unhappiness is qualitatively different, but we're built so that misery preempts a great deal of the happiness issues. So again, sentimentally, I'm with this. I'm worried that we get into an area that's really different from what we're good at.
Hi. John, why don't you answer that?
My experience is a little bit different on that, Marty. I think that, in fact, humans have more in common, and that in any, if you take any group, these are averages we're looking at, you're going to find anything, especially post-crisis, any group, the seeds are there for the rebuilding. Sometimes it's harder to find them. But I'm sure they were strong as well as places. I mean, of course, they got more to gain, and there may be more variance in what you get. But I'd like to see some much more experimentation on that, because the possible gains are much bigger. But I don't think you have to abandon. When you see situations of misery, you're saying
you're nervous about applying the old approaches to removing misery in order to make them happier. I think what Jeff was inviting you to do was take the tools of happiness creation and apply them in these situations among the most miserable. And I have to have it proven to me that they didn't work. And I think it's up to us to look for cases where they have really happened, honestly applied. If they haven't worked, why they haven't worked. And I think it's a legitimate thing to take. And you know, I agree with your notion that the positive approach is the right one. He's given us a place to apply it and see if it really works. I'd like to see it's a high yield investment, risky, but high yield.
If you've listened this long, you're extraordinary. Join the happiness movement. You can use the tools and resources all free at happycounts.org. And I'd love to hear from you. My name is Laura at happycounts.org. Thank you.